那今天现在要分享的主题是在HOD 就是这个OSN 的人道救援制度的组织工作的一些经验，以及他们如何和印尼的雅加达市政府合作，来让基础的组织更为完整，然后就是怎么样让政府跟社群之间开始协作。好，那我们欢迎一边。
So this is the background of why we think that it's really important to have sub-village boundaries. So in every flood occasion, we have this report. So basically, this one reports like what is the height of the inundation during floods, and then how many people affected. This is divided by the sub-district, the village, and then the sub-village. This is the neighborhood, and this is the household. So one RE or one neighborhood may contain 15 to 20 households. And then how many people affected? And this is like the number of dead people, and this is the location of the IED beacon of where people affected during the floods. So we have a very detailed information, but we have a problem in visualizing that information. For example, this is one of the examples of visualizing Jakarta floods in one of the day in 17th of January in 2013. We see that like most of Jakarta is inundated by floods, but that's actually not the case. It might be that only like in this area, only like a partial, like one tenth of that area is actually inundated. But because we only have village level boundary, we have only village level data, so we think that the whole village is inundated. Well, that's not the case, because actually only a very small portion of that area is affected by floods. So we need a more detailed visualization. We need a more detailed understanding about the impact of the floods. Why? Because we have limited logistics. We have limited personnel on how people can help them directly. What if we go to the area because we think that it's heavily inundated, while only a small portion is inundated, but on the other area, almost all of the area is inundated, then we need to prioritize. Then we need to direct our resources into that area. So that's why the importance of the map, because this can be highly politicized, saying that what the government did, or like, oh, Jakarta is really, really flooded. Well, that might not be the case. And it's hard to respond effectively, because we may respond to an area and then only a small portion of people being assisted, while on the other area, no assistance is coming, because people think that, probably just a small amount of the sub-village in the data.
Yeah, because I try to play video and play video is like not working really well, so that's why I choose SMA.
So I may explain to you how we do the mapping through this video.
So basically, this is Jakarta. This is a Jakarta map in 2011. This is based on the data from OpenStreetMap.
As you can see, the flashy point is where people do the mapping. People may add roads, people may add boundaries in Jakarta. And so this is still in the year 2011. This is January, February, March, April, etc., etc.
And then this after December, this is what we have, the spatial data from Jakarta.
And then in March 2012, we have this exercise called Jakarta Sub-Village Mapping Project. So basically, we do the full provincial level mapping of the whole capital. And this is what happens in a very short amount of time. You can see how the data is exploded. And I'm going to explain you how it is possible to make that kind of explosion.
In 2013, we also update the sub-village boundary.
As you can see, that in mapping, you cannot have like, mapping is not the result. It's not the end result, because area is always deadlocked. I mean, people keep on, it's really dynamic. People keep on building things. People keep on making changes to the environment. So that's why in 2013, next year, we also update the village level data. Because we also found out that in 2012-2013, one of the sub-villages in Jakarta is gone. Why it's gone? Because it's converted into shopping malls. So the shopping malls is have an area of a sub-village that's around like 3,000 people living there. It's converted into shopping mall with the 6 or 7 stories. And yeah, so you don't have any more administrative boundary there because yeah, it's shopping mall. You don't have like the half of this village, the half of the sub-village maintaining the area. And this is not certainly the end result. And we also do, Jakarta is one of our projects, and we also train people. This is not us who do the mapping, the humanitarian operation team, but because we train people on how to do the mapping, it's possible to see flashy point everywhere. Because we teach government, we train government, we train NGO, we train universities all around Indonesia on how to do the mapping through OpenStreetMap. That's why it's possible to have this flashy everywhere. In the past 5 years, we have trained more than 2,000 people, and we have certified more than 100 people in the OpenStreetMap platform. So even also government. There's a story where we also trained military, and the military said that, oh, my artillery barrack is still not being mapped yet. Can I map that? And sorry, sir, you don't need to map that. Even because, yeah, the main focus of the mapping is the infrastructure, it's the public use, not necessarily for the military or something that's quite sensitive data. So this is how we do the exercise. We invite all the representatives from the 267 village. If you want to make the sub-village, then the one that we invited is the head of the village, because they're the one who understand the area. So we invite all the representatives of the 267 village in Jakarta, and none of them did not come. All of them coming, and they want to have that area mapped, because it's really important for the purpose of the disaster management, and they want to have their own maps. So, two representatives from each of the village is assisted by one geography student from the University of Indonesia. So this is the student that actually do the mapping. So he just asked like to the head of the village, excuse me, sir, where are the boundaries for the sub-village? Okay, so this is the boundaries. So here is the office of the village, and then here is the temporary camp that people might be affected during floods. And here's the schools, here's the church, here's the mosque, and all the places that might be really useful during floods management. And it goes really well. It happens in less in about a month. But we also, the next month, we do the validation, we do the correction of the data. We sometimes also go to the field directly and try to validate the data to ensure that we have the more accurate data. And so this is the impact. Like the next year, we have more detailed data about the impact of the floods. So eventually, this is true that in this area, that most of them are being flooded. This is this is for the map of all the floods in 2013. So this is like an aggregate. Well, this is only one day snapshot. This is showing you that even in the aggregate, this is showing you how we can focus on which area that we need to support during the floods. And this is also very useful for planning. For example, to prevent the same flood happening in this area, we need to have more assistance, like giving more plan what to do during floods and making more logistic preparation. And we can focus on which area that we may need to concentrate for the floods response in the next year. And we even it also enables more detailed understanding about the extent of the flood or the impact of the floods. Like here, the green number meaning that the inundation is less than a meter, less than 1 meter inundation. And then yellow is between 1 to 2 meters, and this is more than 2 meters inundation. Meaning that we can more able to focus on the area that really heavily affected by floods. And we can like give it more attention, and we also give more attention to other areas as well. Again, because this is on the case of prioritization, because resources are limited, because there are not many people that are able to support during floods because they are also victim. But with this data, we enable to have more prioritization as well as effective response to floods. This is one of the examples, the maps that we produce. So in the end, we are not just collecting the data from them, but we are also giving back the data. Because the data is already put in the OpenStreetMap platform, on the other hand, we also give back this map to each of the villages. And even like, so they can display that map in the area, and they can use that for planning, and they can use that for a broader scope, not necessarily for the disaster management, but also for development, for like how they can plan a future development. Like, where can I build the next clinic? Where can the government build a new hospital, whether it already covers the population or any other purposes. So like, here we can see this is the boundaries of the sub-village. And then, sorry, this is for one village. This is one example of one village, and this is the sub-village. And this is like the religious facility that people usually attracted to during class. And this is the school. And yeah, this is like, so like, for example, in this one village, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 sub-villages. And we extend this effort because even like the disaster management agency thinks that, okay, we now have the sub-village for the whole Jakarta, but how we can improve this better? How we can go into more detailed planning? So we go into sub-village or the archaeological mapping, that is the neighborhood. We go into more detailed level. This is one sub-village. We try this in 35 villages all over Jakarta. We prioritize and we focus on 35 the most prone flood villages. So we look on 35 sub villages, 35 villages, and then we map up until neighborhood level mapping. And it allows more detailed understanding about the extent of the flood. So this is like for one sub village, and then in this one sub village there are 1, 2, 3, 4, around 4 of sub-village or neighborhood level that is have the history of inundated by floods. And it even enables the development of evacuation roads. So we can understand what is the evacuation road in this sub-village map. This is not possible during sub-village mapping because the evacuation road will be really small and it's hard to be displayed or visualized in a map. But this exercise enables that to happen, and we can also like determine where is the IEP camp during floods and how we can do to support them. What is the contact, like the focal point for that IEP camp? So this is Jakarta government showing the map and displaying that how the extent of the map, and use this in one of the television that to explain that even like the government of during this time he still vice government at that time. He able to use the data, and he used that as a decision making in the decision making, because he can understand about what is the priority that we need to focus on, so that people that is assistance really the people that requires much assistance compared to other area. So thank you for the time and listening to my presentation. This is the whole of our team in Indonesia. Again, if you have any question, I will happily answer that. Thank you.
之前有去过，就是你们的办公室，然后其实，在办公室里面有很多的就是其他的开源的组织，然后那像是之前也有听到 Wikipedia 跟 OpenStreetMap 的合作，那可以请你在因为刚刚有提到说有跟 NGO， 有跟 Government， 然后也有跟University。能够请你再举一些例子，关于是这些单位怎么透过你们一起合作的吗？谢谢。
Okay, yes, collaboration is really important because we cannot do it alone, and like disaster is everybody's business, so we need to involve as much as any other organization, any other institution working in this sense. So like how we work with the Wikimedia, we also work on other areas in Indonesia that might not be like heavily affected by disaster, but it also requires this open data. It also requires open data platform on how to support them in doing their everyday business. And we also working with the university, having university roadshow. So So because we think that university is the one that able to be sustainable in mapping the area, because government is having limited personnel. Like in our cases, there is one university that the lecturer is making a task for the or assignment for the student to map an area. And like in some cases, because this lecturer also sell the data and get the money, just simply saying the student to map an area. But it's interesting on how the lecturer is making the students to do the work that really useful not only for them, not only for their part, but also for the society living in that area. So there are cases on how the lecturer integrate this platform into their own curriculum, integrate this system into the curriculum of enables people to utilize the data because it exists in an open data platform so that people from all different backgrounds can utilize the data. So yes, we believe the collaboration with the university, collaboration with the government institution as well as NGO in the area is really important in this activity.
Thank you for your fascinating presentation. I want to extend the previous question. In terms of cooperation, have you encountered any issues when you cooperate with different stakeholders? And what's the major issue for OpenStreetMap in the future?
Thank you. So yes, definitely we always have challenges. And one of the big challenges is usually coming also from the government. Like, there are different kinds of government, there are different offices, there are different institutions in the government itself. Like, in the, like most of this exercise happens because we work with the governments dealing with the disaster management, because they really, really require this data to be able to help people. But there are also other government institutions, like from the national mapping agency that thinks that you cannot trust this data because this only like just people, common people doing the mapping. It's not people having high major or high degree in like in geography or having more credential to do the mapping. So that's the main challenges. But this is about that's also like general problem that you also found in other parts of the world on how crowdsource is not really people not really trusting that kind of platform while that's the only solution available because even this National Disaster Management Agency or Provincial Disaster Management Agency also have frustration about how to get the data. Because in official level, you don't even have that kind of data. If you ask for the village level mapping, for example, it's hard to get them in Indonesia. Because we usually government needs to pay a consultant and the consultant will give them the PDF. Not the study consultant will give them like the raw data. But using this participatory platform, using this crowdsource, that's how we try to answer the challenges. Are those there will always problem of or questions about accuracy, about the validity of the information. Again, we are back to the this platform enables people to map, it also enables other people to validate the information. That's how we maintain the quality of the data. Same with Wikipedia, how there are thousands of editors that working 24/7 voluntarily without being paid to ensure that you have a good quality, you have a very good quality of articles. Thank you.
好，现场好像有黑色衣服的。
I'm very curious about the policy in the Indonesia government that how do they choose so when they encounter this kind of the issues like the making with the hypothesis then how do they choose that they want to collaborate with the big company like Google or the collaboration with like the office community?
Yeah, I was
have
trying to ask Google if it's possible for I tried to ask Google whether it's possible for them to like donate the satellite imagery, but they say that it's hard to do that. So yeah, it's also it depends on at some level we also cooperate with Google because Google now they just bought Skybox and Skybox donates some of the imagery in some in the disaster management purposes. But yeah, we try to collaborate with other organization or institution, but usually the challenge is coming from like their licensing, about how the license is incompatible with us, that they are very limited use of the license. So, but with other company, there's also interest, like from the National Electrical Company in our country, they're very interested to use the platform because naturally every year they need to pay thousands or hundreds of dollars to Google to use displaying the map in their website. But yeah, they're interested to use our platform and saving money. So also there's also a company that interested in using the platform to save the money. There's also a company that interested in like joining an effort in like disaster management. So we try to creatively try to see opportunity on how we can collaborate with companies as well. Thank you. I hope that answers your question.
Today,
how are
you?
我觉得像政府部门在这方面的开放其实是比较被动的状况，那我们想知道说，假设说参与的组织是如何让政府可以主动去参与到OECD的编辑，或者甚至说是不是说有什么政治人物的游说在其中？谢谢。
Yeah, usually because in national mapping agency, that's also a policy about that for the administrative or a very something official or legitimate has to be done by them, has to be done by a certain institution or organization. But there are also other areas we can really collaborate with the government. For example, for the purpose of disaster management, like on how to create this map to be able to tackle flood problems in cities. So we, that's why the humanitarian open map team regularly like cooperate or collaborate with the disaster management agency because they're the one who have the goal or who have the aim to save people. Like there's a case in one of the areas in Central Java where the university is actually the one who approached the local disaster management agency, but it is the local disaster management agency who take the lead on which area that needs to be mapped, because that area may have history of disaster event. So we are looking for an institution that can be based on their own purposes. There is also other institution that lead because they saw the importance of having this data, like the regional planning body in the district level or in the provincial level. Because they don't want, again, to be fooled by a consultant or the third party that simply take the money and then give them the PDF or like the end data that they cannot really use. But using this platform, they can understand the process from A to Z. They understand all the tools and they want to take the lead because they want to make changes in their area. Again, this is not something that's happening everywhere in Indonesia. It's only like specific cases where some of the government are able to take the lead, but yeah, sometimes other government choose just pay the particular consultant and they can have the data, and that's it.
One last question.
想参加这种科技与公民组织的人，可能必须面对一个挑战，一个障碍，就是。 他们科技方面可能没有足够的知识，所以呢，这些组织的创办人可能自己有一些科技上的能力收集资料，然后我们刚刚提到的是，怎么样可以提供一些 open source data， 就是使用怎么使用，然后怎么给大家看，但是问题可能是这些组织。 也不能只是让一群小的人比较少的一个群组做，那你们怎么可以就是把这些组织普遍化，就让比较更多的人参与，也是我觉得也是一个重要的问题。
Okay, so yeah, the how to ask people to more participate in this effort is really a challenge as well. And the one, again, the solution that we try to accommodate is by involving universities. Because if the lecturer or like people from the academician background is the one who do the mapping, it would add more credential to the data, because they're the one who like having the knowledge and they are the one who have technical expertise on doing the mapping. So on how we try to address that, because again the lecturer is the one who has different batch of students every year. So we hopefully there are people or there are students that willing to continue the effort to continue the mapping and add more. Because that's the issue with the challenge with the government. When we try to train government initially in 2011 and 2012, when the people already trained, sometimes they are being transferred to another institution, they are transferred to another office, and they did not continue mapping. The same thing when we try to train the NGO, like if the project is not necessarily involved mapping, then they stop doing that. But it's different with the universities. Once the lecturer is being taught on how to use the platform, utilize it, and they can also use the data, then that might be able to be sustainable in the future, because they understand the importance. They understand that this is really, really useful for not necessarily for this course, but also for the society as a broad. So that's why the partnership with the universities, with the education institution that may be able to make it a sustainable process internally in their own institution, that we hope can continue to be sustainable and support the next generation of mapping and have more again having a credential. This is like the question of the validation, the validity, the accuracy of the data. Because then we have the lecturer functioning as kind of quality assurance, ensuring that the data is valid and accurate. Like in one of the cases, there's a lecturer that giving assignment. If your mapping is good, then you get an A if it's accurate. But if you mapping a bit randomly, like just to get assignment, oh, the assignment is due in 2 hours, so just mapping randomly. But yeah, so he or she might get a C because it's not really doing it really well. But we try, so some of the lecturers have that kind of mechanism to ensuring that while this is participatory, this is crowdfunding, this is crowdsourcing, but you have also the quality in that data as well. Thank you.
好，非常感谢叶哥直接带来关于OpenStreetMap Lacuna 使用，然后 HOP in general. Are you hosting a conference session tomorrow?
Yes.
Excellent. So 明天早上他会主持一个conference session，欢迎大家参加，我们非常感谢他。
谢谢。